Good evening, church. How are you all tonight?
Very well.
Awesome night, isn't it?
Amen.
The Lord is here. We're here.
Hallelujah.
What else do we want? You are blessed. Say to yourself, I'm blessed.
I am blessed.
I'm blessed because of Him.
I am blessed because of Him.
Amen. Tonight we're going to talk about divine healing. And I got a question to ask everyone here. Is God willing to heal you?
Yes. Yes.
Are you 100% sure in your heart that healing belongs to you?
Yes.
Do you know that? Are you your heart secure that healing belongs to you?
Yes.
Okay. Amen. So let's go for. I'm going to start. I'm going to read the scripture from Psalm 119, chapter 119, verse 130. The unfolding of your words gives light. It gives understanding to the simple. Father God, tonight in the name of Jesus, I ask you, Lord, to give us understanding. We come before you, Lord, as just your children, Lord God. We are just simple children, Father God. We don't know our Lord, and we ask you, Lord God, for you supernaturally to open our spiritual ears and eyes to see what the Word of God says, Father God. And Father, your Word says in Romans chapter 10, verse 17, says, faith comes by hearing, and hearing the Word of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. And Lord, I pray that tonight, supernaturally, faith will grow in our hearts, Lord, to be able to believe that what you have for us. And as your children, Lord, be able to accept the free gift of healing that you have for us. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.
Amen. I'm going to take it to Isaiah 53, verse 4 and 5. I know a lot of you are very familiar with the scripture, but we need to start from the scripture because Isaiah, Matthew, and Peter, Isaiah 53, verse 4 and 5, Matthew 8:17, and 1 Peter 2:24 pretty much saying the same thing. And it reads from verse 4, it's, surely he took our infirmities and carried our sorrows. Yet we were considered him stricken by God, smitten by him, and inflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, and he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. The punishment of God was upon Jesus to bring peace to us. Okay? Now, I want to ask you a question. Was this past, present, or future tense? Is it for past, now, or future? Actually, not. It's past tense. Because if we go and read 1 Peter, let's go to 1 Peter, chapter 2, now, I want you please to pay a lot of attention tonight. It doesn't matter if you don't find the scriptures, or even just write it down, but please pay attention to what the Word of God says and what the Lord's doing here. Amen?
Amen.
Okay. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree so that we might die to sin and live for righteousness. And by his wounds you have been healed. Past tense. In other words, 2,000 years ago, you were healed. Now, I'm going to speak a little bit about the last 3 weeks that we spoke about. First of all, we spoke about the love of God. It's very important to know how much you're loved by your Father, because if you don't really believe that you're loved by your Father, you can't really receive the gift. You can receive it when you got to also understand that you had five beside. So when you were saved, you also were made whole. You were healed. Also, the same time you were saved, you were healed. I know about myself. When I got saved, I was suffering from deep depression. And the moment that I got saved, I was instantly healed. I knew nothing about nothing. I knew nothing about the Word of God. I didn't even know who I was. But together with my salvation came the healing. Now, along the way, I lost the healing. Why? Because he who put the sickness into your body, he put the sickness on my body, and the Lord came into my life with power, that sickness had to leave. Because I didn't know that healing belongs to me, in times when you're vulnerable and when you're down and when you're upset, the devil puts it back on you. And on the beginning, I didn't know that that was what was happening in my life. Now, I was totally healed from depression, and also my nose, the heat with the gun back my head, by the crack of my skull, I couldn't smell nothing. But from that moment onwards, I could smell everything, plus the beautiful smell, the lily of the valley. I smelled it all around my apartment for 3 months. Now, that's for everyone, not just for me. As you got saved, the same time you can be healed. Now, what happens along the way? We're going to wrong messages, unbelief, cutscene. Our heart is unstable. We're not sure what's going on. And it's very easy for Satan to come back in and bring the same sickness that was there before. For a long time, now the last 3 years, I myself, when I detect that sickness coming back on my body, immediately I said, in the name of Jesus, I take authority over your Satan, I break your power, and I command you to leave. Because the Bible says in Matthew 28:18, the all authority of Jesus, as I told you the last few weeks, is be given to the believer. We are the body, and he is the head. As it's talking about in Ephesians, also I want to also recap a little bit in Ephesians 1:5. It says that we are adopted in the family of God. Right? The Greek word, it says iothetesis, which is mean son in position or daughter in position. So we are as kings and priests, and we are in position. We are the body, he is the head. Amen?
Amen.
So the authority we have, we must command the devil to leave and take his sickness with him. But you need to know, to be able to do that, first of all, how much your Father loves you. You have to be totally secure in your position as a son. Now, in 1 John 4:18 says, perfect love casts out fear. If we're not made perfect in love, we can't cast out the fear that is coming from Satan. Amen?
Amen.
Also, we know God is love. Now, if we know God is love, and we read in 1 Corinthians 13, verse 4, we can say instead it says, love is patient, love is kind. Let's say, God is patient, God is kind, God does not envy, God is not boastful, He's not proud, God is not rude, God is not self-seeking, He's not easily angered, He does not keep records of wrong. God does not delight in evil, but He rejoices in the truth. God always protects. He always trusts you. Anyone, you. You're a child of God, trust you. Always hopes, always perseveres for us. God perseveres for us. Love, God never fails. So, we know that God is love and He wants every one of us to be totally walk in victory. Now, if we are the body of Christ, I'm sure Jesus doesn't want His body to walk around with sickness on His body, does He? He doesn't want His body to be sick. He wants to flourish. So, where is the problem? Now, is the word the truth?
Yes.
It has to be. So if the word is the truth, who is the fault? We are. And why are we in fault? Because of the wrong teachings, the wrong things that told us in our lives, and we have created this now unbelief in our hearts. But tonight, I pray to the Lord that He will help me to demonstrate to you that God is love and that healing belongs to His children.
Amen.
He wants every one of His children to be totally healed and walk in victory as a king and as a priest. Now let's have a look at Acts chapter 10 verse 38. It says, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how He went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with Him. Now, it says here that He anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power. And He also says here that He done good and healed all, He didn't heal some, He healed all who were under the power of the devil. Healing all. Now, if Jesus was healing all, so also us as the body of Christ, we should be healing all people. Not just some people getting healed, all people should be healed. Okay? Now, in Acts chapter 2 verse 4 says, we also receive the power and the Holy Spirit on the Pentecost. Every one of us, even the one who got saved, will receive power and the Holy Spirit. The same resurrected power, the resurrected Jesus from the dead, it lives inside us. We have the Holy Spirit living inside us. The same power that Jesus did all the miracles, inside us. Amen. Now let's go to Luke 13, chapter 13, verse 16. Then should not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, who Satan had kept bound for 18 long years, be set free on the Sabbath day from what bound her? See, the Pharisees were too interested to worry about the Sabbath, but Jesus was more interested about her. And he said, shouldn't a daughter of Abraham? Why did he say Abraham? Because God had a covenant with Abraham. Okay? God had a covenant with Abraham, and she was a daughter of Abraham. And now, because what happened with Jesus, because it says in Galatians chapter 3, verse 29, says, the blessing of Abraham was given to him and to his seed, one seed, which is Jesus Christ. So if we are in Christ, all the blessing is also on us.
Amen.
So this woman who was for 18 years bound, the Lord totally healed her and restored her. No physician could do nothing with her. Nobody could help her. She was bound. Amen? Amen. Now, let's also look at John chapter 10, verse 10. The thief. Now, we all know the thief is the devil, right?
Amen.
Comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they might have life and have it to the full. Now, here it tells us the thief comes to steal and kill and destroy, but Jesus has come to give us a new life and to the fullest. If we're not living a full life, it means that something is wrong with us. We're missing it somewhere. And it's important tonight to go through the scriptures and discover that the healing belongs to us, and we should all be whole tonight. Totally healed tonight. Amen? Okay. Now, in Acts chapter 3 and from 4 to 8, we see Peter. He says, Peter looked straight at him, as did John. Then Peter said, look at us. So the man gave him his attention, expecting to get something from them. Then Peter said, silver or gold I do not have, but what I have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk. Taking him by the right hand, he helped him up, and instantly the man's feet, ankles became strong. When Peter looked at this man, there was no evidence that this man was healed. He looked at him and he saw in his eyes this man had faith to be healed. There was no evidence, though, that this man would be healed. And he spoke the finished work of Calvary. He commanded this body, because he saw this man he had the faith to be healed. He commanded this body to stand up and walk in the name of Jesus. And this man got up and walked. Amen? Now the same thing happened in Acts chapter 14, 9 to 10. Paul did exactly the same thing. He listened to Paul as he was speaking. Paul looked directly at him, saw that he had faith to be healed. And he called there, stand up in your feet. And the man jumped up and began to walk. Again here, this man was hearing the message of Paul. As you guys hearing the message tonight from me about the goodness of God, the same thing, this man was hearing Paul preaching the gospel. And faith come by hearing, and hearing the word of God. Amen? And Paul saw in this man's eyes that he had faith to be healed. He said to him, in the name of Jesus, get up and walk. And this man got up and walked. Again, there was no evidence when Paul said, stand up and walk, that this man was healed. That this man was still, he was crippled, on the floor, paralyzed, could not do nothing, but yet the word of faith was spoken, and he saw this man had faith to be healed, and he got up and walked. Now God, because he loves us so much, he wants to meet us wherever we're at. He will meet you tonight, wherever you're at. He says to you, how much faith do you have? I remember when our sister said a few weeks ago upstairs, she said, I believed that I'd be healed the end of the year. She believed that she'd be healed by the end of the year, and she was healed at the end of the year. Because that's as much as she believed. It doesn't mean, Lord, that you could not be healed the same day or the same week. And we know some healing is gradual, some healing is distant. Some healing is by laying on the hands. Some healing is by speaking the word of God. Some healing is come supernaturally from God. There's different things in different places, but God wants to heal everyone, every person, regardless to who you are and what you've done in your life. If you're in Christ, you're qualified. Now, as I said, when I was first got saved, I did nothing to deserve my salvation. I was one of the chief sinners. And yet, he came into my life, not only saved me, he healed me at the top of it as well. So the healing, it's for free. Because in Ephesians chapter 2 verse 8 says, for it's by faith we have been saved through faith. Not by works, so no one can boast. So your salvation and your healing, it's based in His goodness, not in our works. Don't think, in other words, if you're going through something in your life, well, because I'm not working properly, God's not going to heal me. No. That's wrong. That's wrong teaching. God wants to heal every one of us. Amen? Amen. Now, let's look at some more scriptures, eh? First John chapter 3, verse 8 says, the devil has been sinning from the beginning. So the devil, he loves sin, he loves deception, he loves lies, and he's the father of lies, we all know, and he will do anything to blind us, not to be able to receive the free gift of healing that God has for us. Because he's just a liar. Now, in the Old Testament, let's look at the Psalms 103. In the Old Testament, they were the servants of God. They were under law, these people, okay? But we have a better covenant, the Bible tells us in Hebrew. They were under law and they were servants. So if a servant can be healed, what about the child of God? Let's look at 103, chapter 103, verse 3 to 5. And it says, who forgive all your sins and heal all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and cleanses you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. Now, this is what the Lord was talking about even when they were under law. Let's look at also Psalms 107, 11, and then 17 and 20. Psalm 107. For they had rebelled against the word of God. Here it tells us they were totally rebelled against God. And then in chapter 17 it says, some become fools though they were rebellious in their rebellious ways and suffered afflictions become of their iniquities. They offered all foods and drew near the gates of death. Then they cried out to the Lord in the trouble, and he saved them from their distress. He sent forth his word and healed them. He rescued them from the grave. Here again, it's a very clear picture where people sinning, going to the world, let the devil come into the house, they don't clean up the houses and make sure everything's nice and clean in the house. And when the trouble hits them, they don't go to church, they don't fellowship with the body of Christ, they're by themselves, working by themselves, and they think everything is good. The devil puts them in the corner and then he kicks them. And when in the end, when the trouble is everywhere and they know they don't know what to do, they say, God! And then God, through his mercy and his love, he says, I want to help you. Come here. I love you. Why you run away from me? Why you run away from me? I love you. Why do you run away from me? Why do we run away from God? He is the only one who loved us unconditionally. He wouldn't even spare his own son and give it all for us. God so loved the world, he gave his one and only son. He gave everything. God is not holding anything back from you. And yet sometimes some believers believe that God doesn't heal them. That is, God is not giving me healing. And he says, God, why don't you heal me? You know what? About two years ago, I had a spiritual spear by sudden on my back. And I walked around for 4 months, going like this, sideways, and couldn't even walk, standing, always in pain, couldn't even sleep at night time. And I went to all doctors, I took so many pills you can't even remember, I can't even remember, my wife can testify, I was just pills, and I was not getting well. And every time we prayed, the Lord would tell me, I healed you 2,000 years ago. I mean, I healed you. Just take your healing, it belongs to you, just take it. And I'm praying, and one night on the other church, on the old church, I thought, some of you remember it, I thought, you know what? I need a healing. I'm going to preach about healing tonight. And I preached about healing. Before my sermon was not even finished, the spear was gone. Why did it go? Because I have persuaded my heart through the teaching, as I was preaching, my heart was persuaded that the healing belongs to me and I'm a child of God, so therefore I should have it. So instantly my heart made the choice of commanding Satan to leave and take his spear with him because he was trespassing. See, any sickness in your body that he puts, he is actually trespassing. And he will not leave If you don't believe that you can be healed, if you don't believe that healing belongs to you, if you don't believe that you're a child of God, if you don't believe that you have authority over Him, and you know, you hear a lot of Christians who say, "Sight under my feet, under my feet, under my feet." Why are you saying it under your feet? If you know you're a child of God and you're walking in victory, you walk over Him. You don't have to tell Him you're under my feet. You already know He's under your feet. And that's why we have to come to that understanding that we as children of God, we have got all authority and will command sickness to leave our bodies for us and for our children, for our relatives, for our brothers and sisters, for our moms and dads. We have got authority. So in the spirit of our family, we can command Satan to take his filthy hands off us. Amen?
Amen?
So we should no longer lie down and just accept whatever everything he gives us and says, well, you know what, that's the way it is. No, it's not the way it is. And I remember that the same night, 20 times the same symptom came up on my body. And I said, no, devil, in the name of Jesus, I rebuke you. You're not coming back on me. 20 times I had to rebuke him to stay away from me. If I said, obviously I thought I was healed, but I'm not, then you would go, bingo, take it again. It's yours. It comes back on you again. How many people that you know that get the flu? Right? And the flu, it's sickness. Now the Bible tells us all sickness comes from Satan. So if you're a believer and you get the symptoms of the flu, whether you resist it 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, 4 days, 5 days, as long as it takes until that sickness will not stick on you, or that you get another Christian who says, brother, I got the flu, will you pray for me? Well, you already said, I got it. So if you already got the flu, it's yours. He gave it to you and you take it and you're happy with it and you're living with the flu and no prayer of anybody can do anything to you because you already accepted that situation that the flu belongs to you and therefore you should have it. So we need to start thinking as kings and as priests. We start thinking as children of God. Not some beaten up Christian that, you know, my life is so bad and I don't know, you know, I don't know if God even loves me, you know. A lot of people think that. Let's continue on some more scriptures. You know? Now in Hebrews chapter 8 verse 6 says, we have a better covenant because of the blood of Jesus. In Hebrews 8:13 says, the old covenant is being aging and old, and soon it's obsolete, it's gone. Aging is gone. The Old Testament is gone, and we are under new covenant in the blood of Jesus. And everything that Jesus has belongs to us. And we as His body, we should have everything, and we must walk in that understanding and reality. Amen? Let's look at now Mark 11, and all of us know the scripture, okay? 11:22-24. Chapter 11, verse 22-24. Have faith in God, Jesus answered. I tell you the truth. If anyone says to this mountain, go and throw yourself into the sea, and he does not dare in his heart, but believes, and that he has, he says, will happen, it will be done for him. Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours. Any mountains that you have in your life, all you have to do is believe and it will be yours. Amen? That's what the word says. All you have to do is believe. And it's us. Now, James 5:14. Now this is another very simple, I reckon this is the easiest way for people to be healed. Because, as I said, God has, He wants to meet us where we're at. If you haven't got all the five, well, this is the scripture that very clearly says. James 5:14 says, is any of you sick? Now, they were asking, is any of you sick? Today in churches, there's a lot of people that are sick, a lot of Christians are sick. Those days, he was asking, is any of you sick? Actually, there weren't many people here sick those days. He should call the elders of the church to pray over him and anoint him with oil in the name of Jesus. So, only thing to do is, you're in the church, you ask the elders to pray for you and anoint you with oil in the name of the Lord. Okay? So far, so good? So far, as you see, it doesn't require any of your five. Other than tell an elder to say, can you please pray for me? Right. I'm sure that's easy for everybody to do that. The prayer offered in five will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise him up. Now the prayer is offered by the elders to the person who is sick in five will make this person well. The Lord will raise him up. If he has sinned, he will be forgiven. So if you got sin in your life, the Lord is going to forgive you anyway. Amen? Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray. It's important if you something you're struggling with to confess and pray over it and the Lord will forgive you on that spot, on the spot. So that you might be healed. The prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. Now, who is righteous? Every person who is in Christ is righteous. If you look at 2 Corinthians 5:21, it tells us that we receive our righteousness in Christ. God's given us to be righteous in Christ because of Jesus. Okay? 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. So we are righteous before God because of Jesus Christ. Amen? So, we are righteous. So, if you're not in the church, you're already righteous because of Jesus. So, doesn't mean that, oh, this person is not really righteous. No, no, no. You don't get your righteousness from yourself. That comes from the Lord. Amen? It's a free gift from the Lord. Everything we have is for free. Okay? Now, Elijah was a man just like us. Here the Bible tells us that Elijah who called fire from heaven and burned everything and stopped the rain of coming for 3.5 years and then it rained. He says, he was a man like us. He prayed earnestly and would not cry, and he did not rain on the land for 3.5 years. Again he prayed, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth produced its crops. So don't look for the super apostles, okay? We all have giftings from God. It's a free gifting. And it's He who does the work. We are just vessels, and you need to draw the healing out of Him, out of me, out of whoever. And God will meet you wherever you're at. Now, yeah. Matthew chapter 7 verse 11 tells us that Jesus was saying, you who are able to give good gifts to your children, how much more your Heavenly Father will do for you. Now you got to understand one thing here, and I wanted to talk about this a little bit. Jesus was a teacher of the law. That was before the resurrection. Are you all listening to me? Jesus was a teacher of the law, was before the resurrection. So he preached law. When you are his children of God, as it says in first, as it talks about Ephesians chapter 1 verse 5, we are now the covenant, the new covenant started when Jesus said, it is finished. The law was finished and the new covenant started. The covenant of grace. So we are under grace, okay? So that, if you are evil, is for the people who are not saved and the people who are not under the covenant. So don't think that we, the children of God, are evil. We're not. We are cleansed by the blood of the Lamb and the word of the testimony. Amen. We are His children. Amen? Because if you think you're evil, how then are you going to go to your Father to accept His gift, free gift of healing? If your heart's not certain, and it's like this, and you're not sure, you're not going to go to him. You're going to walk away from him because you're not going to think that you're measuring up. Whenever you think about who you are in Christ, measure Christ with the Father. Don't measure yourself with the Father. Measure Christ because you are the body of Christ. So you measure how good Christ is with the Father, that's who you are. Amen? Now, we know, I know a lot of you weren't here when I preached about the authority of the believer, but also I want to speak a little bit from Mark 16, verse 18. Now, it talks about that about the laying on hands. Okay, verse 18 says, they will pick up snakes with their hands, that's you, and when they drink the deadly poison, will not harm him at all. They will place the hands on the sick people and they will get well. Again, by the laying on hands, if that's the way you think you can receive your miracle tonight or your healing tonight, is you can receive it that way. If you have enough faith for the Lord healing himself, you can receive it that way. God wants to meet you anywhere you are comfortable at so he can heal you. By faith. Amen? Now, in Acts chapter 3, verse 17, it says, the man who Peter told him to get up and walk, he had faith in the name of Jesus. And the man became whole because he had faith in the name of Jesus. He said to him, in the name of Jesus, get up. So this man must have been listening for a long time there, even when Jesus was preaching, and he knew that Jesus was a healer. So when he heard the name of Jesus, his heart raised up, he believed, and that hope, therefore, he was healed. Amen? Now, in Matthew 18, chapter 18, Matthew chapter 18, verse 18, it tells us that I tell you the truth. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you lose on earth will be loosed in heaven. I can tell you that if two of you agree on earth about anything you ask for, it will be done for you by the Father in heaven. For where two or three come together in my name, there I am with them. Two of us with five, and Jesus, we are majority. Amen? Mm-hmm. And we can bind. We have the authority to bind the works of the enemy. We have the authority to command him to leave. We have the authority when you go, and for instance, if one of you, if your husband is not saved, your wife is not saved, and you go home, and he causes trouble at home, he says, in the name of Jesus, I bind you now, Satan, you will not operate here right now. It will be done for you. Because you're a child of God. And we are seated in heavenly places, far above all principalities. So we are seated in heavenly places, far above all principalities. Not some principalities, all principalities. So, your little toe, it's got more power than the Satan if you believe it. That's how much power we have. All authority, actually, the word power in Greek is authority, exousia, means the authority of a king. Not an invocable authority. That's what it's given us. Now, in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9, it talks about the gifts. To another 5, but the same Spirit. To another gift of healing by that one Spirit. So, God gives supernatural healing. Some people got the gift of healing, and they can lay the hand anytime on the person, and the person will be healed. Last Thursday night, when we were here, and I was praying for people, my whole hand was hot, and it was twitching. The Lord wanted to heal every person here, whoever wanted it to be healed. The healing was available for everybody, but not many people thought they could be healed, or believed they could be healed. So well, that's the reason I decided this week to teach about healing, that the healing it's ours and it's for free. And every one of us should have it. Amen? Amen. Now I wanna now some healings if they get done supernaturally by God, okay? In John 5, chapter 6, John chapter 5, verse 6 to 8, it talks about the man who was in the pool for 38 years. And God supernaturally, every here and then, would stir the water, and the first person who jumped in the water would be healed automatically. Now this man, the Lord asked him, do you want to be healed? He starts saying to the Lord, you don't understand Jesus. I'm here for 38 years, every time I try to jump in, somebody else jumps in before me and I can't be healed. But this is what the Lord asked him. The Lord asked him, do you want to be healed? He should have said, yes, of course I want to be healed. But anyway, the Lord said to him, pick up your mat and go. And then after when he saw him, he told him, stop sinning. In other words, this man must have been sinning. So you got to understand, when people sin, open the door for Satan to come in to bring sickness. If your life is completely clean, he has got no authority, and you can command him to leave your body, he has no place in your life at all to touch you. And that's why, and this was a supernatural healing by God. Because this man had no faith. So the Lord also tonight could do miracles of healing to some people that have no faith at all. It's his kingdom, and it's his power, and he does it the way he likes it. And but one thing I know for sure, he will go to every length to see every one of his children healed. Because he loves us. Amen? Now let's look at this. This is very important. I want you to pay very attention, a lot of attention on this scripture. Mark 5 from 28 to 34. Now, this lady, she thought, if I just touch his cloth, I will be healed. This is how this lady knew how to be healed. She thought, if I just touch Jesus, I'll be healed. That's where her faith was. If I just touch him, I'll be healed. Immediately, her bleeding stopped and she left her body, and then she was freed from her suffering. At once, Jesus realized that power has gone out from him. Jesus realized that power left his body. Amen?
Amen.
Now, a lot of times, the power of God, I know it's in my hands, and God wants to release it, but the person stops it. And then I feel the pain go up my hand. And the same thing, she drew the power of Jesus. Jesus did not pray for her, he did nothing. She had her faith, drew the power of Jesus, and Jesus told her, who touched me? And we know, I know, there's times when the power comes out, flowing out of my hands, and times when the person says, no. He doesn't say no, but his heart says no. Understand? Your mind might think, I want to be healed. But your heart says, I'm not sure. I'm not sure about this God. I'm not sure about this person for me. But I want to let you know that the healing is for everyone here tonight.
Amen.
And God wants to heal every person here tonight.
Amen.
What you're going to do is draw it from him or from me or from anybody else who's praying for you. Amen?
Amen.
So, now let's... At once, Jesus realized that power has gone out from him. He turned around and the crowd and asked, who touched my clothes? You see that the people crying against you, his disciple answered, and you can ask who touched me. But Jesus keep looking around to see who has done it. When the woman, knowing that she has been what happened to her, came and fell at his feet, and trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. He said to her, daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering. Now, I want you to pay attention here. There's four things that I want you to know. She said, if it just touch him, I'll be healed. Number one, the first step this woman did was, if I just touch him, I'll be healed. Second, she went forward and did it. Right? First she said, if I just touch him, I'll be healed. In other words, when you come forward, or I'm praying for you tonight, he says, if you just touch me, I'll be healed. Because God can heal me. Because the healing is for me, and it's for free, and I should have it. So, number one is you say it in your heart, not in your mouth, in your heart, and you say, sure, I'm going to be healed tonight. In other words, have expectation in your heart, tonight it's my night, and I'm going to be healed. Whatever that might be, the problem in your life might be. So first she said it, and then she did it. So in other words, not just say something and then not carry it through. You say it, you move forward, and she touched it. And then she received it. Number three. She didn't say, well, I'm not sure if I'm going to be healed tonight. She walked away, I'm healed. It's mine. And not only walked away that she said it's mine, the fourth thing she does, she proclaimed it from her mouth. Proclamation is very important. Proclaim that you are healed. Not from the head, from the heart, just to believe it. I'm healed. I'm done. Because the word says I'm healed, so therefore I'm healed. It's very simple. Simplified. So that healing took 4 steps. She said it. She did it. She received it. She spoke about it. Amen? Now, let's look at Luke 17, verse 13. And they called there in a loud voice, Jesus, Master, have pity on us. When he saw them, he said, go show yourself to the priest. As they went, they were cleansed. Now, when Jesus said, go in and show yourself to the priest, there was no evidence on those people that were healed. Okay? But they, because he said it, they believed it. And they turned around and they went. One of them saw he was healed, came back, praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was Samaritan. Jesus asked, were not all 10 cleansed? Where the other 9? Where's the other 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner? Then he said to him, rise up and go, your faith has made you whole. Well, 10 lepers, they got healed from leprosy. They didn't even know they were healed. He told them to go, so they believed they would be healed, so they took off. One of them, when he realized that he was healed, he came back afterwards and fell in the feet of Jesus. Now, you got to understand here, leprosy, people who had leprosy, they had holes in the fingers, all in the nose, and the faces. They were really bad disfigured. Okay? The man who came back, and he was a foreigner, Jesus said to him, rise up and go, your faith has made you well. He was complete. He was totally restored to the original why he was before he even had any leprosy. So he got double healing here. First he was stopped, the disease continued, and then he was completely restoration. In other words, can you imagine it? Fingers with broken fingers missing completely because of leprosy, and then fingers grew out on his feet, on his nose, on his ears, whatever was missing was restored totally. Now, you know that we have 5 senses, okay?
That's right.
We can hear,
we can see,
we can smell, we can taste, we can touch. But that's not the same. Healing is not the same. Healing is by 5. You speak 5 and you expect to see the manifestation of the healing. It's not feeling. You know, people says, for instance, if somebody prays for you and he says to you, how do you feel? Oh, I'm not sure. I'm still feeling the pain. Well, feeling's got nothing to do with it. Because the healing can be instant or can be a gradual. Now, I got some true stories here that I'm just going to say a couple of stories because the time is going by and I think I might need to do another time because this is not something that you really need to grab it and put it in your heart, and this is a lot, it needs a lot of, your heart needs to be really convinced. And I believe a lot of people tonight, they're receiving, they're getting it, they're grabbing it. And but we want this church to be totally free from any sickness.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Amen?
Amen.
Now, 7 years ago, I was in Vietnam. And I knew nothing about nothing. I was just a very young Christian. And they told me to pray for this lady. When I prayed for this lady, she was crying, I was crying. She had cancer, and she was a pastor in the throat. The year after, when I went there, she said to the interpreter, is this this man, can you tell me, does he remember me? I said, yeah, I remember you. He said, do you remember you prayed for me last year? I said, yeah, I remember you prayed for me last year. He said, I'm totally healed from cancer.
Hallelujah.
Okay? So that was this woman was completely restored from the cancer she had. Now, in Namibia, 2 years ago, one day, as I said to you many times before, I was feeling really terrible. And I said to the Lord, why am I feeling like this? He said to me, son, that's the way you feel, that's exactly how I feel for these people here. Mm-hmm. On that time, instantly I knew how much God loved these people in Namibia. And when I was praying for somebody where his leg was like that, and he was walking like this, and I went down and I put my hand there and I said, in the name of Jesus, be healed. I heard the bones cracking and the leg coming straight. Oh. And he started running up and down.
Hallelujah.
Amen?
Amen.
He started running up and down. I was more amazed than him. Because I didn't see that sort of thing. I've seen a lot of other miracles, but not actually cracking the bones and straightening up with this man walking up and down. Oh, in another town in Namibia, this lady had AIDS. She had AIDS. And again, the same thing. Because I knew how much God loved us at the end, do you know how much God loves you? And as I laid my hands on her, she got totally healed. And she came back 2 days later with a report from the doctors. She was completely cleansed, fully cleansed from AIDS. Now, we know HIV positive, it's a very, very, very bad disease, okay? The Lord also healed her. Now, also I want to tell you that a few years ago, when my son was sick, I was very young in the Lord, and I write down New Year's Eve to what I want the Lord to do for me. And actually forgot about my son that he was sick and he was suffering from depression. I said, oh my God, I forgot to write down that I want my son to be healed. And as I start writing, the Lord said to me, why don't you pray for him? Okay, all right, well. Now, I had no idea about the teaching that I'm talking about now here. Okay? But I knew then and then that it was God's will to heal my son. And I prayed then, and the same night my son was totally healed from depression.
Hallelujah.
Amen?
Hallelujah.
Now, and also here on Friday morning, we have seen so many miracles, Friday after Friday. The people who have been here will tell you, people getting healed here all the time. So it is God's will to heal you. Amen?
Amen.
Now, what we spoke so far tonight,